Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh and we are going to start with our NCRT classes. Okay, as you know that we have started NCRT, the 9th standard geography. And today you will have the second class for that. Okay, so we are finishing the NCRT books one by one through these lectures. You can subscribe the Future IAS on the YouTube where you can get it, the NCRT based lectures. Okay. And these lectures are basically useful for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination conducted by the Union Public Service Commission or UPSC, as well as other government competitive examinations. All right. So you can always refer our channel on the YouTube where you can easily find out Future IAS. Okay. And you will get it, the daily current affairs, sorry, daily NCRT based classes. All right. So we are going to start with our the 9th standard geography today. All right, so let's begin with the lecture for today. Okay, all right, so today we are going to start with the drainage. Okay, I have a lot of pictures for you for understanding the drainage. So when you say the drainage is a basically term which refer the river system of a area. For example, you have the Ganga river. Okay, the Ganga river basically has its tributaries also, its distributaries also. The drainage basically term we use to refer the river system. The river system means it will have obviously its tributaries and the distributaries also in a particular area. So that will be called the drainage system of a area, the drainage system of a river. Okay, so drainage system basically will be consisting of its tributaries and the distributaries also. The combinedly called the drainage system. Okay, when you say the drainage basin is basically the basin which is drained by a single river system. For example, the Ganga and its tributaries drain a particular area. Okay, a particular basin. So that area is called the drainage basin of a Ganga river system, the drainage basin of a Ganga river system. Okay. And there is also one term which is called water divide. The water divide, we use basically the term for signifying, right, the dividation or the separation of two drainage systems. For example, there are two streams or two rivers which used to flow. Okay, the divide which separate these two river systems are called the water divide. It generally is upland because uplands only can separate the two drainage system. Otherwise, these two drainage system can be merged together. So that upland is called water divide. Okay, so here you can see in this picture you will have the water divide which is generally upland, and here you will have the stream A, that is river A, and the stream B, that is river B, and it is their drainage basin. It is their drainage basin, and this is basically called the river system for stream A, and this is called river system for stream B. So here you can see there are, you know, tributaries. These are tributaries of these rivers, the main rivers. Okay, these tributaries used to meet this main river, and it is the main river. It is the main river. On the both side you have the tributaries, the left side of this river, because you will consider this is the flowing direction of the river. So it is basically, you know, the it is basically your downstream side. Okay, it is the downstream side of the river. It is basically the upstream side of the river. Okay, and these, since we are taking this direction, so they are called the left bank tributaries. They are called the left bank tributaries. Okay, and they are called basically the right bank, the right bank tributaries. Okay, so like that, in this system also you can see it is the upland which is a drainage, which is a divide, or which is the water divide. And these are the tributaries. If we consider this is the flow direction, so they are called basically the left bank, the left bank tributaries. Sorry, they are called the right bank tributary. They are called right because if you just stand over there by projecting your face this direction, your right hand will be in this direction. So they are called right bank, and these tributaries are called left bank tributaries. Okay, they are called left bank, and they are called basically the right bank tributaries. All right, fine. Then on the basis of origin, there are two river systems in India. Okay. Primarily, first is Himalayan river system and the second is Peninsular river system. So first of all, basic difference between two river system is that the Himalayan river systems or the Himalayan rivers basically originated from the higher reaches of the Himalaya. Okay. They flows from the hilly areas of the Himalayas and they entered into, you know, on the plainer areas, right? Then they flow on the plainer areas. The peninsular rivers are also originated from some hill areas, but they are located in the plateau area or in the peninsular areas. Okay. Then in terms of regime, right? The Himalayan rivers are rain fed and the snow fed both. That means since you have seen that the Indus River, Ganga River, right, Brahmaputra River, all are originated from the glaciers, right? But they are also rain fed also, right? So their regime is both rain fed and snow fed. Okay. And that is the reason their water remains throughout the year. So that is why they are considered as a perennial, and thus they are navigable. That means you can use your boat, right, in this river to basically sail through these perennial river system. The Himalayan river system basically create the meanders. Meanders means since they enter on the plain, they basically due to the heavy load and due to the less gradient, they basically meander in this shape. So this is called meandering. And one such loop can also be cut down and the river started flowing straightly. And this is basically formed the Oxbow Lake and other depositional features on their land. We will be learning the more about the depositional features as we graduate in our higher classes. Okay. But the Himalayan river systems basically generally form the Oxbow Lakes and the meanders and other depositional features. Unlike the Himalayan river, the peninsular rivers are seasonal. Seasonal ka matlab hota hai, they are only rain fed. They are mostly rain fed. Okay. They don't have the glaciers for their, you know, for their feeding purpose. So they are mainly rain fed. That too, during the rainy period of the time, they flow, right? And during, you know, drier period of the time or during winter period of the time, they generally, you know, they generally have very less amount of water, or sometimes they also get dry also. So that is the reason they are non-navigable throughout the year. That is what they are also non-perennial rivers also. Non-perennial means they don't flow throughout the year, right, with the minimum flow level. Okay. And most of the river of the peninsular India originated in the Western Ghats and flow towards Bay of Bengal. So if you see the protruding, you know, the map of India or peninsular India, you see basically this is Western Ghat that we have studied yesterday. These are Eastern Ghats. So most of the rivers basically originated from the Western Ghats and moved towards the Bay of Bengal. But there are very few rivers which originated from the Eastern Ghats and moved towards, you know, towards Western Ghats. So majority rivers basically flows towards the Eastern Ghats since they originated in the Western Ghats. Okay. So let's see this figure, the rivers of India. So here you will have the two types of river system. The first is basically the Himalayan river system. And the second is basically the peninsular river system. Okay. The three main river systems constitute the Himalayan river system. They originated from the Himalayas. The first is Indus river system. The second is Ganga river system. The third is Brahmaputra river system. All three comes under the Himalayan river system. Then you have the peninsular rivers. These peninsular rivers are basically main rivers. You see the Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri, Narmada, and the Tapi. These are the main rivers of the peninsular, right, part, or they are called peninsular rivers. Okay. Among them, the Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna, and Kaveri, they are east flowing rivers. They are east flowing rivers. That means they originated in the Western Ghats and flowed towards the Bay of Bengal, right? Narmada and Tapi, they are west flowing rivers. They are west flowing rivers. That means they originated in the Eastern Ghats and flows towards the Arabian Sea. All right. Let's understand about the Himalayan rivers. As I told you that a river system is something which is made up of the river and its tributaries. For example, if I make a river system, you will understand. For example, these are the rivers. Okay. So here you will have, you know, the main river is this. This is basically the main river. Okay. So you can say this is main river. Okay. And this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This 1, 2, 6 are basically called the tributaries. The tributaries of rivers, the river system. And here at that also you may have this. You may have this also. So they are called distributaries. For example, 7, 8, 9, 10. These 7, 8, 9, 10, they are called distributaries. They are called distributaries because they distribute the water from the main river. From the main river, it is also known as the source. Source means from that point where the river originates. And it is also called the mouth. It is also called the mouth where the river meets with, you know, some flatty surface or where rivers basically form the delta or some other things. Okay. So it is called mouth. And you may have the distributaries also which distribute the water of the river. Okay. The major Himalayan rivers are basically Ganga, Indus and your Brahmaputra that you all already knows. Okay. Let's understand first Indus river system. So first of all, you must understand the Indus River basically rises near Mansarovar Lake in the Tibet. So it is basically, right, rises in the Trans-Himalayan ranges, right, from the Lake Mansarovar in the Tibet region. The Indus River basically enters into India in the Ladakh district of Jammu and Kashmir. So it enters at the Ladakh in the Jammu and Kashmir. And it has, right, the tributaries of Ravi, Chenab and Jhelum, right, joins Indus near Mithankot, Pakistan, right, and thereafter they flow southward to fall into the Arabian Sea east of Karachi. So these Satluj, Vis, Ravi, Chenab and the Jhelum, they are called the tributaries of Indus River system, right. They join Indus near Mithankot in the Pakistan, right. It is the length of this Indus River is around 2,900 kilometers and it is one of the longest river of the world. It is considered as one of the longest river of the world. So if you see the figure, so here you see, first of all, the Indus River, which originated from the Mansarovar, near Mansarovar in the Tibet. So here the Indus River basically originated. It flows in this direction to the northwest direction. And here it enters India. Right, then it's four, you know, it's five basically tributaries here, the Jhelum, Chenab, Bias, Satluj, Ravi. They are basically, you know, the tributaries which meets the Indus at Mithankot and enters into the Pakistan, right, and it enters basically, you know, India at the Ladakh region. All right, then understand Ganga river system. The Ganga river system basically, you know, it's basically originated or the headwaters of the Ganga, which is called Bhagirathi. Okay. Bhagirathi. So Bhagirathi is basically the two headwaters of the Ganga where they both met, right? This Bhagirathi is basically fed by a separate glacier, which is known as Gangotri glacier. This Bhagirathi is joined by the Alaknanda at Devprayag, which was also known as Allahabad, right? So previously it was known as Allahabad, but now it is known as Devprayag. So both Bhagirathi and your Alaknanda both joined as Devprayag, and hereafter they basically flows on the planar areas, right? And here the Ganga meets its tributaries. So Ganga also has the tributaries from the Himalayas. For example, Ghagra, Gandak, Kosi and the Yamuna. These are the important tributaries of Ganga. Okay. The most important tributary of Ganga is basically Yamuna. The Yamuna arises from the Yamunotri glacier in the Himalaya. And this Yamuna joins Ganga at Allahabad. Yamuna is Allahabad. All right. The other important tributaries of the Ganga is basically the Chambal, Betwa and the Son. which are coming from the peninsular uplands to join Ganga. So it is not that the all the tributaries of the Ganga is flowing from the Himalayan reaches. There are tributaries which also originated from the peninsular uplands and which join the Ganga in the planar areas. Okay. And as this Ganga flows from upstream to the downstream, it goes to, you know, basically Bangladesh. So here the Ganga is joined by the Brahmaputra River. This combined stream basically flows into the Bangladesh and ultimately reaches to the Bay of Bengal. Okay, the important delta which is formed by the Ganga and the Brahmaputra both, right? When they reaches to the Bay of Bengal, it is known as Sundarban Delta. So Sundarban Delta is the delta formed by the Ganga and the Brahmaputra combinedly into the Bay of Bengal, right? It is known as Sundarban Delta. The total length of the Ganga is around 2,500 kilometers. And this river basically developed a large meandering tendencies, right? All right. So this is basically the Ganga river system. So you see basically the Ganga, which is, you know, flowing this way. Okay. This is the main Ganga river, which is flowing. Then entering into the Bangladesh, right? Here the Brahmaputra is coming from this side. It is known as Padma, Jamuna. The combined stream is known as Padma, right? And then they ultimately meet with Meghna and ultimately form the Sundarban Delta. Okay, you see the tributaries of the Ganga from left bank side. You see basically the left bank important tributaries are Gomti, Ghagra, Gandak, Kosi, right? These are the important left bank tributaries of the Ganga. The right bank tributaries, you can say Chambal, okay, Yamuna, Betwa, Tamsa, Son, right? These are the important right bank tributaries of your Ganga River. All right. Then understand Brahmaputra River system. The Brahmaputra River system basically originate in the Tibet region again, very close to the source of Indus and the Satluj. The Brahmaputra enters the Arunachal Pradesh and flows into Assam, joined by many tributaries. So what happens is the Brahmaputra, when it enters into the Arunachal Pradesh, it flows through a gorge. It flows through a gorge that is nearby to the syntaxial bend, right? So it flows through the gorge and it basically enters into the planar region in the Assam, right? The tributaries of the Brahmaputra are basically Devang, Lohit and Kanula. These are the important tributaries of the Brahmaputra. The Brahmaputra has the braided channel in its entire length in the Assam, right? So these braided channel form many riverine islands, right? The world largest riverine island is also located on the Brahmaputra itself. Okay. And the Brahmaputra, since it suddenly take the hairpin bend through the gorge and enters into the planar areas of the Assam, it bring lot of deposits of the silt. So these deposition of the silt on the bed occurs, right, which causes the riverbed to rise every year and which causes, you know, tremendous flood in the planar regions of the Assam every year. In the planar region of the Assam, every year it causes the floods. Okay, so here you see the Brahmaputra in the Tibet region is called Tsangpo. It is called Tsangpo. It basically move in this direction. And here it takes sudden, you know, hairpin bend. It entered, right, in the Arunachal Pradesh and then Assam region. Its important tributaries are Dibang, Lohit, Buri Dhiang, Diku, Subanshri, Dhanshri. These are the important tributaries of the Brahmaputra. And then it entered into, you know, then it meet with the Ganga and, you know, the Ganga and the Brahmaputra meet. Its combined stream is known as Padma. Then it met with upper Meghna and the combined stream is known as lower Meghna and ultimately, you know, form the delta in the Sundarban. Delta is a Sundarban Delta. So this is very long river which originated from the Tibet region, flows horizontally towards, you know, eastern direction, take the sudden hairpin bend and joins the tributaries of Dibang, Lohit and Buri Dhiang and Diku and enters into the plainer region of the Assam, and then started moving and met with the Ganga River and enters into the Bangladesh to form the Sundarban Delta at the mouth of, you know, the Bay of Bengal. Okay, let's understand about the peninsular rivers. The peninsular rivers. So as I told you that the peninsular rivers are basically are, you know, their regime is not perennial. First of all, they only flows, you know, during the rainy season only. So they are not navigable. Okay, and they are only mainly rain fed. Okay, and the major rivers which flows, you know, basically towards eastern directions. So they originated from the western ghats and they flows towards the Bay of Bengal. But few rivers basically originated from the eastern ghats and flows towards the, you know, Arabian Sea also. So major rivers of the peninsula are Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna and the Kaveri. These are the main rivers of the peninsula. These flow eastward and drain into the Bay of Bengal. Okay. The Narmada, right, are the only rivers which flow to the west and makes the estuaries and drain into the Arabian Sea. So Son and the Narmada, both. Okay. So Son and the Narmada, both of these rivers basically flows to the western direction, right? And, you know, sorry, not so. It is Tapti. It is Tapti. And the Narmada, both of these rivers basically flows, right, to the western directions and form estuaries and the drain into Arabian Sea. The drainage basin of the peninsular rivers are comparatively smaller in the size because they don't have the enough water, first of all. And they basically, you know, do not have that much amount of sediments also that has been brought by the, as it has been brought by the Himalayan River. So here, the Godavari is important peninsular river, right? So Godavari basically originate from the Nasik district of Maharashtra, okay? And it is the largest peninsular river. And it is the eastward flowing river. It flows towards the Bay of Bengal. It has the large basin which covers, you know, certain states, for example, in the Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, Orissa, and the Andhra Pradesh. So four states are basically covered by the river and its tributaries as its basin. Okay. The important tributaries of the Godavari River are basically Vardha, Purna, Pranhita, Manjra, Venganga, Penganga. These are the important tributaries. Okay. And because of its length, it covers the Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, Orissa, and the Andhra Pradesh and drain ultimately into Bay of Bengal. Due to its length, it is also known as Dakshin Ganga or the Southern Ganga. It is basically the name which is, you know, came from the Ganga River. Ganga is also having the tremendous higher length, around 2,500 kilometers, right, which is also comparable with respect to the Ganga, with respect to the Godavari. And Godavari ultimately drains into the Bay of Bengal. Okay, let's understand about Mahanadi Basin. So Mahanadi is another important peninsular river. So first of all, Mahanadi rises in the Chhattisgarh region, right? And its length is around 860 kilometers. It flows through Orissa and it reaches to the Bay of Bengal. That means it is also the east flowing river. It is also the east flowing river. Okay, it rises in the Chhattisgarh, especially the Chota Nagpur Plateau. The most important tributaries of the Mahanadi are basically, you know, the Shionath, Jonk, Hasdio, Mand, Iv, Ong, and Te. These are the important tributaries of the Mahanadi. Okay, the Mahanadi basin or river basin is shared by the four states, the Maharashtra, Orissa, Jharkhand, and the Chhattisgarh. Right, these four states basically shared the Mahanadi and its, you know, tributaries basin. And it is one of the most important east flowing peninsular river, which is draining into the Bay of Bengal, which is draining also in the Bay of Bengal. Okay, let's understand about the Krishna Basin. So Krishna is also most important river, comparatively larger when you compare with, you know, Mahanadi River. So it is around 1400 kilometers long. The Krishna River rises from the Mahadev Range near Mahabaleshwar, right, in the Maharashtra, All right. And it is basically rises from the spring. Okay. And it falls in the Bay of Bengal. That means it is also the east flowing river. It is also the east flowing river. The important tributaries of the Krishna are basically known as the Bhima, Musi, Ghat Prabha, Koyana, Tungabhadra. These are the important tributaries of the Krishna. The Krishna basin is shared by the Maharashtra, Karnataka and the Andhra Pradesh. So Krishna is comparatively have the longer course when you compare with the Mahanadi. It also, its basin is shared by the Maharashtra, Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh. All right. Let's understand Narmada basin. So Narmada is also most important river, but it flows to the western direction. It flows to the western direction. So it is west flowing river. It is the west flowing river. It is the west flowing river. That means west flowing means it basically ended up in Arabian Sea. It ended up in Arabian Sea. So the Narmada River basically rises in the Amarkantak plateau of Mekal Range. Okay. So it rises from the Mekal Range and it basically flows through a gorge in the marble rocks of Madhya Pradesh. That means it flows through, right, a fault, right, which is created as a gorge in the marble rocks of Madhya Pradesh. Okay. And it is flows through a rift valley, which is formed due to the faulting. So as I told you, it is through the faulting, the rift valley, which is formed. And through this rift valley, the Narmada River used to flow from the Mekal Range or precisely the Amarkantak Plateau towards the Arabian Sea. And it formed basically estuary. Okay. So this is the major difference between the east flowing river and the west flowing river. The west flowing rivers generally make, the west flowing river generally makes the estuaries and the east flowing rivers make the delta, right? Because the east flowing rivers are comparatively larger in the course. They are having more sediments because they cover the significantly larger area. So they brought a lot of sediments along with that. And these sediments are getting deposited, right, at their mouth in the form of delta, in the form of delta. But unlike in the, you know, unlike the east flowing rivers, the west flowing rivers do not have the larger course of the river. Moreover, they flow through very hard rocks. So they don't have, so they have comparatively lesser amount of, you know, the sediments, which are basically plunged from the higher reaches directly into the ocean and which form the estuaries, right, when they meet with the ocean. The Narmada has 41 tributaries with them. The most important tributaries are Barna, Ganzal, Chota Tawa, Hiran, Jantara, Kolar, Orsang, and Seh. These are the important tributaries. So the Narmada is known for the having the large number of such tributaries. Okay, let's understand Tapi. So first of all, Tapi is also the west flowing river. Tapi is also the west flowing river. Okay, now west flowing river means it basically ended at the Arabian Sea. The Arabian Sea, it ended at Arabian Sea. So here the Tapi is originated in the Betul district of the Madhya Pradesh. The Tapi again flows through a rift valley only. Okay, so its basin cover the Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat and the Maharashtra. Okay. The main best flowing rivers are also Sabarmati, Mahi, Bharatpuza and the Periyar. These are also the important best flowing rivers, okay, which are found in our, you know, peninsular region. Okay. Now this entire Tapi basin can be divided into three sub basins, right? First is upper middle basin, the lower basin, right? And which is, you know, again into well-defined physical regions like hilly regions and the plains or the Tapi region. So the Tapi is most important river, which is flowing towards the western direction. Okay. And the other important west flowing rivers are Sabarmati, Mahi, Bharatpuza and Periyar also. Okay. Let's understand Kaveri basin. So Kaveri is also most important river. Okay. Again, it is east flowing river. again, it is the east flowing river. That means it originated from the western ghats and moving towards the eastern ghats. That means towards the Bay of Bengal. Okay. So it originated in the Brahmagiri range of western ghats. Okay. It originated in the Brahmagiri range of western ghats. The Kaveri reaches to the Bay of Bengal at Kaveri Patnam. Okay. And, you know, they basically, you know, sharing its basin with the Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Kerala and the Pondicherry, right? And the main soil which is found on the Kaveri is basically red and the yellow soils which are found, especially in the Tamil Nadu and the Kerala region on the basically in the basin of Kaveri. Okay. Then understand lakes. So lakes, you must understand, right? Lakes are basically, some lakes are permanent, some lakes are not permanent, but generally the most of the natural lakes are permanent. Okay. And these lakes actually contains the water, right? Mainly in the rainy season of the time. Sometime this water can be used, right, by the stakeholders during the non-rainy season also, right? Some lakes are also result of the glacial action. That is called the glacial lakes that you have seen recently in the Chamoli district of Uttarakhand because of the glacial outburst. Okay. The lake water which was stored, right, which basically released suddenly and caused the havoc and basically the flash floods in the Chamoli district of Uttarakhand. So these glacial lakes are basically formed due to the moraine, which are basically the boulders, pebbles, which are left over remnants of the glacier, which after the glaciers melt. Okay. So it has basically formed, or it has basically deposited in the form of the embankment, and this basically stored the water due to the climatic changes. Now, what happens is due to any sort of a disturbances, either because of avalanche or because of, you know, any, you know, flow, right? If it is breached, because it is very unstable, no human elements are involved in the formation of the glacial lakes. It is due to the climatic changes, due to the glacier retreat, these glacial lakes are formed. Okay. It can be easily breached and it can cause the sudden release of the water, the millions of the gallons of the water in a short span of the time, and which can cause the flash floods in the downstream region. Then some lakes are result of ice sheets, and some have been found formed by the winds, river action and the human activities also. So humans also form these lakes, right, for various purposes, right? The river meandering across the flood plains forms a cutoff, and later it develops into the Oxbow lakes. Now what happens is when the rivers is basically meandering in such a way that it took, you know, some time, very, you know, meander in such a way that it's take on the meandering and ultimately cut off from the main route, and river started flowing directly and connecting these two places and formed the Oxbow lakes. We'll be learning more about the Oxbow lakes as we graduate in our higher classes. But the meandering loop is basically cut off from basically the main river channel, and ultimately the leftover portion will be converted in the form of Oxbow lakes. Okay. The glacial lakes, I have given you the example of the glacial lakes. The glacial lakes are formed when the glaciers are dig out of basin. Okay. So when the glaciers are dig out of basin, okay, and later this has been filled by the snow melt water, and it is basically, you know, this water is basically, stored, right, because of this moraines and because of the deposition of the boulders, pebbles and a lot of other things. Okay. Some lakes like Vullar Lake in the Jammu and Kashmir, right, is the result of the tectonic activities. Tectonic activity is something which is related to the movement of the plates. Okay. So these Vullar lakes is because of the tectonic activities of the plates. Okay. Apart from the natural lakes, the damming of the rivers for the generation of hydel power is also led to the formation of lakes. For example, you have the Bhakra Nagal Dam. You have another different type of, you know, dams which are constructed, or these lakes are constructed, right, for the run of the river projects. For example, in the in the Chamoli district of the Uttarakhand also, where the flood came, the hydro power project is also impacted. It was run of the river project, right? And it was severely, you know, destructed or disturbed because of this flash floods. So again, a lake is formed, right, through which a river or through which through the narrow channel the water is flowed with the high speed, and that speed is basically used for the, you know, rotation of the turbine, and that is, you know, used for the basically generation of the electricity. Okay, so again, the natural lakes can be formed. Apart from the natural lakes, you have the damming of the rivers. This damming of the rivers is used for the generation of electricity also through these hydro power projects. Okay, the lakes basically help to regulate the flow of the water. Obviously, the water can come, they can basically have some, you know, time, so residential time for the water is also there. It can also prevent flooding, right? It aid to the development of the hydro power, right? It moderate the climate also, because the microclimate can be affected positively with the help of these lakes, and it will also help in the development of hydro power generation. The maintain aquatic ecosystem, because such lakes are very good reservoir for, you know, aquatic, you know, flora and the fauna, and also it enhance the natural beauty nearby. It can also promote the tourism and other recreational facilities. Okay, so generally these lakes, which are man-made or artificial, they boost the tourism, recreational activities, and definitely promote the aquatic floral and the faunal composition in the area. So these are having tremendous, you know, the supportive services which are provided by the lakes. Okay, now let's understand the role of the river in the economy. So what are the roles of the rivers provided in the economy? So first of all, the rivers provide the natural source of water. Water is most important asset or most important source, without which the human cannot live, right? So water is the most important resource, not only for the human, but also for the animals and other flora and the faunal composition. Okay. And water is also the backbone for the agriculture. Even our farmers are dependent, right, dependent on the water, right, for their agricultural operation. So rivers are playing very great role in terms of the providing of the water for the drinking, as well as the providing of the water for irrigational, you know, facilities also, right? Then, you know, the settlement on the riverbank has developed into the cities. Now, as I've told you that the early civilization basically settled, or the early civilization begin, right, their development all along the riverbanks, because these riverbanks provide a lot of avenues. For example, in terms of, first of all, providing of potable water, drinking water. Also, the riverbanks are generally fertile. It gives also avenues for agricultural development. It provides the much needed water for the agriculture and other associated, you know, activities, right? So the settlements basically started nearby the river source, right, or nearby the riverbanks, and which later converted into the cities. A lot of cities are basically, you know, set up on the banks of the rivers. The rivers are used for the generation of irrigation, right? Rivers are used for the irrigation purpose, for the navigation purpose also. For example, Ganga, Brahmaputra, they are navigable to certain extent. The hydropower generation, as I told you that, it can be dammed, right, where the water can be stored. This water can have the run of the river water projects, hydropower project, and this can be used for the generation of electricity also, right? It is all vital for India, as the India is basically an agricultural based economy. Okay, it is very vital, very important for the agricultural development of our country, right? So without water and the role of the rivers in this perspective is very, very important, right? The role of the rivers is very, very important. Okay, next, the river pollution. So as you know that the most of the rivers in India are polluted. The Ganga, Yamuna are the most polluted river, or comes among the most polluted river in our country. Not only in our country, but also in the world. And this pollution is due to the mainly anthropogenic regions, or human-made region, or the man-made region. The humans are chiefly involved in the pollution of the river, okay, because there are a lot of, you know, reasons for this river pollution. First of all, the untreated, you know, waste, which have been released directly to the water. Okay, so quality of the river water is affected by the growing domestic, municipal, industrial, and agricultural demand. Okay, so here the demand is increasing for the water. Obviously, the potable water is, you know, is finite. It is not that something that is, you know, you can use wastefully, or you are not sustainably using the water. So obviously, the water demand is growing day by day because of domestic, because of municipal, because of industrial development, because of agricultural demand, right? To fulfill all those demands, first of all, we need to optimally utilize that water. And moreover, a heavy load of untreated seaways, heavy load of industrial effluents, which are directly released to the water bodies. Now, when these untreated effluents are directly released to the water bodies, what happens is it causes so much damage to the aquatic, you know, floral and the faunal composition, right? First of all, these untreated seaways basically cause the dissolved oxygen to be depleted. This dissolved oxygen, right, is more important, right, for the sustenance of floral and the faunal composition. If the dissolved oxygen will not be there, right, from that place, either the aquatic, you know, the faunal species, either they migrate or they die because of suffocation, right? So that excessive amount of seaways, untreated amount of seaways, because the water has its own, right, the capacity to clean the water, right? But that capacity is not unlimited, right? So we need to maintain, first of all, a clear level of flow, right? And moreover, the untreated seaways should not be excessively dumped, right, into the river, so that it crosses the river's self-cleansing property. So that self-cleansing property is that property of the river through which river generally cleans its water by its own. So which is most important with respect to the river water flow, right? And the concern over the rising of the pollution in our rivers also led to the launching of various action plans, right? For example, Narmada Bachao movement was started, right, in the backdrop of protection of the Narmada River from the pollution, right, from the damming of the Narmada River. Then further, you have a lot of governmental schemes also, right, which led to the beautification, right, which led to, you know, the right compulsorily, right, treating of the wastewater. Now there is heavy penalty, and a lot of other mechanisms have been put in the place for treating of the wastewater. The government is also emphasizing on the setting up of the sewage treatment plants, the effluent treatment plants, right? The industries cannot directly release the water into the water body. They first, you know, treat that, you know, the effluent, then only they can release. The BOD or biological oxygen demand of the water should be that much, right? So a lot of other, you know, the technical parameters have been brought in, right? So government is doing a lot, but still there are a lot to do, and our rivers are severely polluted, right? Which should be cleaned in the phased manner, and we need, you know, the support from almost all sections of the society, then only our rivers can be pollution free. And once the rivers got polluted, right, and also the water from the, you know, from basically from the ground source is also depleting very fast, because we are extracting the water from the ground source. So now it is very, very difficult for the extraction of this ground source water also. So it can also deplete over the period of the time, and it will be very, very difficult for the water to get it from these rivers. And already India is also the water scarce country, right? So let's understand once again what we have studied today in our class. So we have studied basically the drainage, what we have studied, the drainage system, the river pattern, okay? What is water divide, okay? We have studied, right? Then we have studied the two major river systems, the Himalayan river system, the peninsular river systems. We have seen the difference between the Himalayan river system and the peninsular river system, okay? Then we have seen the important rivers, like Himalayan river systems, peninsular rivers. We have also seen the most important difference between the Himalayan river system and the peninsular river system. Then we have covered the Indus river system, right? From where it originate, how it flows, its tributaries and etc., its length, okay? Then we have seen the Ganga river system, its origination, its flow, its length, its tributaries, etc., right? Then we have seen the Brahmaputra river system. In the Brahmaputra river system also, we have seen its origin, its flow, its tributaries and etc. Okay, then we have seen important peninsular rivers. The peninsular rivers can be east flowing rivers or can be west flowing rivers. Okay, we have seen the important peninsular rivers like Godavari river, Mahanadi river, Krishna river, Narmada river, Tapi river. The Narmada and the Tapi both are west flowing rivers. That means both dump their water in the Arabian Sea. And remaining rivers basically flows towards eastern side. That means they dump their water towards Bay of Bengal. Then we have seen Kaveri, right? Kaveri is also east flowing river. Then we have seen lakes, different type of lakes, natural lake, man-made lake, the importance of the lakes, right? The glacial lakes, right? Also the uses of the lake, what is the utility of those lakes, how the lakes are very important for the sustenance of the human in terms of providing much flow of the water, preventing the floods, developing the energy or electricity by the hydropower projects, moderating the microclimate, right? Protecting the aquatic ecosystems, etc. Then we have seen the roles of the rivers in the economy also in terms of irrigation, navigation, hydropower generation, etc. Okay. Then we have seen the most important part is river pollution. So river pollution is the most rampant. Because of river pollution, like almost all of our rivers are heavily polluted beyond imagination. So we need to have the full-fledged cooperation from every section of the society in order to protect the river. All right. So thank you very much for this class. We will meet again tomorrow for our next class. Thank you very much.